The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Today's topic, I'm going to explain that there are 10 intangible skills that set you apart in your job search. There is no denying the importance of having strong skills in order to get hired for a job, but there are other skills that are just as important as the traditional work-related skills you will need. In fact, they might even be more important. Often referred to as soft skills or intangible skills, these are the traits that set you apart from other candidates. The Business Insider article, Shake Shack's millionaire founder Danny Meyer says he will only hire people with these five skills, highlights the necessity of soft skills during a job hunt. Meyer admits that when he first started hiring for his restaurants, he would only hire people with strong technical skills. What he discovered was that some of those technically proficient employees lacked a love for what they were doing, and it showed. Some people who had the least impressive technical skills ended up being the biggest stars at the restaurant, while others with the most impressive technical skills ended up weighing the ship down. So now, the famed restaurateur looks for a melange of strong technical and soft skills, of what he refers to as innate hospitality skills. The good news is that these skills can be applied to almost any job in any field. And I have expanded on Meyer's five skills and added my own below. So, here are 10 intangible skills that will set you apart with your job search. Number one, exhibiting optimism. If you think about it, practically every employer would want to want an optimistic employee. After all, who wants to hire a Debbie Downer? Optimistic people can help motivate a team when time gets tough, and they are quicker to tackle harder assignments that others might be reluctant to take on. Showcasing a positive can-do attitude during the job interview can help potential boss see how enthusiastic you are about the job. So be sure to highlight an example of when you were positive while others weren't and explain how your optimistic made a difference. Bree Reynolds, FlexJob Senior Career Specialist and Career Coach, suggests for many jobs, it's also important to exhibit optimism throughout the job search, and that can be tough when you're applying to jobs. Not hearing back and getting frustrated, nervous, or just tired. Try really hard to show your optimism throughout the process, from your cover letter to the final interview. It really stands out to employers. Number two, being kind. Think cutthroat character will help you get to the job search finish the line faster? Think again. The ability to be kind is an intangible skill that can go a long way in winning over a hiring manager. By being kind isn't just reserved for potential coworkers or your future boss, it's also for everyone you meet along the way, from the security guard who gave you the building pass to the receptionist who asked for your name not once, but three times. Because believe it or not, if you are rude or short with people, that can spread pretty quickly and negatively impact your chances of getting hired. Number three, being intellectually curious. When an employer brings on a new staffer, they want that person to be excited about the opportunity to work for the company. But they also want something else too, a genuine interest in the job. They want to see that you are passionate about the position on the whole, as well as other components of the company. In short, an employer wants an employee who never stops learning and plans to stay with the company in order to grow with the position. Intellectual curiosity can start in your cover letter. Show the employer you've done your research to understand the company and how the job they are hiring for fits into the biggest picture. And during job interviews, prep throughout questions, thoughtful questions to ask the interviewer that go beyond the basics. This isn't just a job search tactic. By asking more in-depth, curious questions, you are getting inside info that can help you decide whether or not this is the right job for you. Number 4. Developing a strong work ethic. Yes, many employees start off strong when they are first hired. They show up on time, sometimes stay late, and tend to work just a little harder in order to show their devotion to their job in their company. But after a few months or years, that can start to wane. As an employee wanders into the office late, leaves early, and begins to put out support work, so during your job interview, to set you apart from other candidates, show your strong work ethics by citing examples of when you have gone above and beyond in the previous positions. That said, there is a fine middle ground of making sure that your drive meshes well with team members and the company culture. Nobody wants to work with a show-off who brags about how many hours they work or how you think you work harder than everybody. That's an instant turnoff. Number 5. Possessing empathy and self-awareness. Whether you are working in an office full of noisy coworkers or from the quiet of your home office, being empathetic to the other members of your team and to your boss needs to can go a long way. You need to be aware of your actions and how they affect others, from having strong communication with your colleagues to being able to pass off a project to the next team member on time. Working is a self-absorbed bubble, either in the office or at home. Won't win you any prizes or get you hired. To set you apart from other candidates, be sure to show that you are in tune to your potential employer's needs when you sit down for your interview, and you will win major bonus points. You'll also be able to have a better discussion about how you can help. Number 6. Having integrity. Integrity is not taking all the credit for the project when your partner did more than half of the work. Integrity is a critical component of an employee's success. It shows a prospective boss that you value the team and its success over your own. It's an emotional skill that can be hard to find in some job seekers. But working with integrity and honesty is not only the right thing to do, but sometimes that employers desperately want is in their workers. This intangible skill is an absolute must. Number 7. Being a person of your word. Let's say that you are applying for a remote position and are given a performance test. You tell your prospective boss that you will have it completely by Tuesday, but then Wednesday rolls around and you are nowhere near done. Rather than admit your error, you silently submit your test on Thursday, without an explanation or apology. What do you think your chances are for getting hired? Kind of shaky, right? When it comes to your job search, it's important to say what you mean, and mean what you say. If you tell a potential employer that you're going to handle in materials by a certain date, make sure that you can make that deadline. Otherwise, the first impression that you're giving your boss might be that you're unreliable, flaky, or untrustworthy. It also shows that you don't communicate proactively, which can present serious problems on the job. Standing by your word shows honesty, integrity, and also and dependability, all of which are intangible skills that can set you apart from other candidates. Number 8. Having good follow-up skills. On a daily basis, your job search might look like this. Read listings, revise your resume, customize your cover letter, and send in your application. But what about following up on your applications? Some job seekers find following up tricky, believing that if a company is interested, they should reach out to you. Others are afraid of bothering a potential employer. Thing is, you never know what can happen to your application after you hit send. Maybe your computer glitched and your application never went through, or it got accidentally deleted. Following up, believe it or not, can be an attractive quality to a prospective employer. It shows that you A. really want the job, B. have the courage to pursue it professionally. Wait about a week or two and then follow up on any outstanding applications that you haven't heard back about. Number nine, having self-confidence. Job searching can leave your ego a little bruised. From not hearing back from employers to reading lists for jobs you really want but don't have the qualifications for. It's easy to lose your confidence, but it's important to be self-confident during your search. Self-confidence will give you the gumption to go after the jobs you really want and explain to a potential employer why you really deserve the job. If you doubt yourself and your ability to do the job, you might subconsciously send a signal to your interviewer that they should too. Number 10. Being trainable. When you are applying to jobs, you want to put your best foot forward, presenting to a prospective employer that you are completely able to do the job. That said, you don't want to look like you're possibly a know-it-all, like untrainable. If you give off a being there, done that impression, it would be a big turnoff. That's why you should know how to present your past experience and skills in a way that shows the employer that you are qualified for the job, but also eager to learn the policies and practices in order to be a successful employee too. Reynolds says being trainable also means taking responsibility for your continuing education. Seek out training now, independently, to increase your skills, then show employers the work you've already done to advance your abilities and stay ahead of the curve in your field. Using your intangible skills to land the job you want. So these are 10 intangible skills will set you apart from other candidates and really for your life too. If you're looking for a new opportunity, flex jobs can help. And I partner with thousands of companies to offer flexible jobs in more than 50 career fields. You can reach out to me and we can set up an appointment and discuss more in details how you can be qualified for those jobs that I'm partnering with.
Hey, did you know you could get paid to travel the world and teach English? I'm Tamara with Let's TEFL. And I'm here to introduce you to the world of teaching English overseas. Native English speakers are in high demand all over the world. Think Thailand, China, Italy, Spain, and schools will pay around $2,000 to $3,000 per month for qualified teachers. It's a great way to see the world and get paid at the same time. With our online course, you can become a certified English language teacher and work all over the world. You don't need any previous teaching experience. You can study at your own pace and gain your qualification within a few weeks. We'll provide extra training to help you pass job interviews. And we'll even help you find an exciting job overseas. So what are you waiting for? Click the link below and get started today.
Is your career by design or default? Whether you have been in the world of work for 30 minutes or 30 years, a career path requires thought, effort, and cultivation. In the book Alice Through the Looking Glass by Lewis Carroll, Alice has a discussion with a cashier cat. Alice says, "Would you tell me, please, which way I ought to go from here?" The cashier cat says, "That depends a good deal on where you want to get to." Alice says, "I don't much care where." And the cat says, "Then it doesn't much matter which way you go." And Alice says, "So long as I get somewhere." And the cat says, "Oh, you're sure to do that. If only you walk long enough." Like most of you, I'm frequently asked, which course should I take, and what's my next step? And my first question, just like the cat says, in essence, is where do you want to go? In the book, Alice responds, I don't much care where, so long as I get somewhere. Like Alice, most people respond similarly. I don't have a plan. I just know I want to go somewhere. This back and forth between Alice and the cat has been swimming around in my head for a while. Now, as I connect with learning professionals around the world, those of us with the most expertise on developing and expanding skills on career paths and development often neglect our own careers, whether you have been in the world of work for 30 minutes or 30 years. A career path requires thought, effort, and cultivation. Take a moment to stop and reflect on your career to date and answer this question. Was your path to this point by design or by default? For many of us, it's by default. We find ourselves in a job and aren't quite sure how we got there, or we suddenly realize we've been in our current role forever. So let's define your vision. Do you have a plan? If not, I encourage you to carve out some time and make one. Alice didn't care where she went, but if you really thought about it, I bet you do care. If you close your eyes and imagined the perfect role, what would it look like? That's it. The first step is having a career by design, is to find your vision. Step one can be challenging because it requires you to reflect on what you want. What is my career aspiration for the next 3 years? What is important to me? How do I feel about my career? How do I love spending my time? Get clear about what you want so you can ask others to support you. Now that you have defined your vision, you have to determine what it will take to get there. What skills do people in that role have? What experiences have they had? Identify the specific expertise, knowledge, and skills you need to be considered for that role. One way to do that is to leverage LinkedIn, Indeed, or other websites. Look at the profiles of people who hold the type of positions you aspire to. Look at the job descriptions for roles that intrigue you. What skills do the job descriptions mention? What accomplishments do the profiles contain? This will give you some insight into the skills you will need to be considered for that role. Then, it's build your skills. Once you have a better idea of what you will need for that next role, you need to take an inventory of your current skills and then leverage the resources around you to fill in the gaps, whether it's taking a class, listening to an expert, watching a series of training videos, getting a certification. It's time to take action and acquire the skill sets. This could include raising your hand for a new project at work or asking someone to be your mentor, but don't rule out the volunteer world. Haven't had much experience with budgeting? Consider volunteering for a charitable organization. There isn't a fundraiser coordinator out there who would turn away help with handling the finances. Have you had the opportunity to learn to lead a team at work? If not, you can obtain those leadership skills through myriad volunteer activities. Ask for specific help and you will be surprised. As you build out your skill set, bucket your development goals into industry knowledge, skills related to the discipline you are seeking, and personal leadership skills. How well do you know the business you are in? Do you understand the key metrics and drivers of that business? Do you have skills and experiences in the more cutting-edge components of the learning field? Do you have skills and experiences in the more cutting-edge components of the learning field? Are you leveraging agile methodologies in your design approaches, or are you still stuck on analysis, design, development, implementation, and evaluation? Networking is another key step in the career process. When thinking about networking, I break it down into three buckets. Networking within your industry. Meet with someone who holds your job at another company within your industry. Networking within your discipline. Connect with other learning professionals in a variety of industries. And networking within your company. Seek out individuals from other departments, those you don't interact with often or knowing nothing about what they do. Every year, I identify three people in each category I want to meet, I connect with, and learn from. Just like any goal, success comes when you commit to yourself and to others. I found that when I ask someone to hold me accountable, I stay on track. Be specific with your request. For example, ask someone to help you update your resume or to connect you with someone in his or her network. If you take these steps, you will find it's much more likely you will find yourself in the perfect role doing what you want to do.
Hello, this is Sara Yusupov. Stop by my show, Let's Talk Careers with Sara, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern, where I will discuss about your dream job, career coaching, answering your questions regarding careers, exclusively on TuneIn Satellite and their Armed Radio Global Networks.
Now, this I'm going to say about more marketing. If you are a marketer at your work and you want to be better, I found an article from the Sales and Marketing magazine that you need to know your customers better than your competition does. The foundation of an effective marketing strategy is a comprehensive knowledge of customers' needs, having a better sense than your competitors for what creates customer value provides a huge advantage. In fact, they say the goal is to have a better sense than even your chosen customers themselves. So here are the steps that I'm going to share with you. And just be ready, pen and paper at all times when you are listening to my episodes. So number one is spend more time with a customer than your competition. Marketers generally spend no more than a few days a year face-to-face with those who buy their products. Quality time with customers is great, but quantity is even more important. Decision makers who spend enough time seeing the day-to-day lives and challenges of their customers have a level of understanding that staged drop-ins cannot provide. In addition, they can get the credit that comes from being the supplier that is willing to walk in its customers' shoes. The consumer insight is best gained by frequent face-to-face contact with consumers and customers. But it can also be augmented through short, inexpensive surveys with quick turnarounds. The knowledge gained and hypothesis generated from frequent surveying can make your physical time with customers much more productive. The number two is watch consumers buy your product. How do new customers find you? What is the customer experience? Use Google Analytics to monitor how customers navigate your website. Where do they land? Where do they spend time? And where do you lose them? So, John Deere saw an opportunity after watching landscape contractors get ready for an installation job. They saw these contractors spend hours going to one dealer to pick up sod, another for gravel and stone, and another for topsoil. The trek continued on to pick up paving stones, sprinkler system parts, and lighting supplies. Since jobs weren't planned well, many of these outlets were visited multiple times on the same job. From this insight came to the formation of John Deere Landscapes, the landscaping contractor's one-stop shop for not only parts, equipment, and horticulture, but also for landscape, design services, and consumer financing support. Number three is watching consumers use your product. Observing consumers as they use your product or receive your service is the perfect chance to understand which features create value, which ones are never used, and which ones actually get in the way. Watching customers use your product can help you make it better and also develop new products. Number four, engage end users as product designers. Too few companies realize their customers can become partners in product development. Customer partnerships have become common for software companies, which frequently employ groups of beta users to try out their products and provide feedback for product refinements. Now, there is a boutique diving watch manufacturer, Celos, partnered with a Facebook dive watch group. Instantly, the 32,000 members of this group felt as an affinity for the new diving watch models, which they had helped to shape and design. Not only did Zelos benefit from the group's expertise, it also gained the advocacy of leading influencers in the market. And the last thing is don't sink in customer data. The copious amount of data available on consumers is invaluable, but it also creates a dangerous temptation to spend hours and hours analyzing spreadsheets and runs the risk of confusing quantification for the true understanding. So now you know how to serve your customers better than your competition does. You spend more time with a customer than your competition. You watch customers buy your product, and you watch customers use your product. Engage end users as product designers by having partnerships. And you provide the clear customer data. When you are focused so much on your customer than just on sales, you provide valuable information for your customers, and they will vouch for you and give you the testimonials that you are looking for. So, if you want to be a great marketer, this is the way to go. Now, another thing I want you to focus as a great marketer manager, that social sellings reduces marketing budgets. So many digital marketing executives are expected to deliver the same or better results. Social selling is a proven way for marketing teams and sales professionals to connect with their audiences. It is within these social networks where prospects and customers live that smart marketers and salespeople build personal brands, demonstrate thought leadership, drive engagement, and ultimately nurture relationships to generate inbound leads that deliver revenue results. So here are four simple steps to becoming a social selling leader. 1, demonstrate your expertise. Today's buyers are looking to do business with companies or individuals who they trust and can provide specialized knowledge and expertise. Every time you engage in social media, you have the opportunity to create an impression that you or your brand are thought leaders, whether it's offering your unique insight on relevant content that you have shared, or having an interesting commentary on other people's content. Publishing on social lets you present a perspective that builds trust and confidence. Create interactive conversation. Beyond sharing interesting content, the best way to drive visibility for your post or ensure its longevity, like more than 20 minutes, is to create real and meaningful conversations. Standard measures on social media, such as likes or images, are nice, but they don't mean much in terms of resonating with the audience in a way that drives leads. The best posts generate thoughtful response and have others chiming in to lend support on an idea or offer a counterpoint, if you want to initiate a discussion but steer clear of controversy, prompt your audience with a question, share a personal story, or ask directly for feedback. Then engage with your audience. Once you've created for contributed or contributed to a conversation, don't stop there. If it's something you started, be active in responding to comments that are left. Thank people for sharing their perspective. Present a counterpoint to an argument with which you disagree. Respond with how you are going to apply feedback they might have provided. Every interaction you have reflects on your ability to position you or your brand's expertise in your domain or product area. Social media should be a dialogue, not a monologue. And the last thing I would say is connect. Connect, connect, connect. Once you have people buying into your expertise, it's important to connect to these individuals as they represent the qualified leads you are hoping to engage with professionally and convert to new customers. Be sure to personalize the invitation by referencing the interaction you had with each other and your interest in connecting. One note of caution, don't take acceptance of your invitation to a connect as license to immediately sell them something. This is often a big turnoff at this early stage of relationship building and can get you a blacklisted immediately. Nurturing a relationship needs to happen over time, but connecting is the first step to building highly qualified, engaged prospects. As marketers, you will continue to face cost-conscious environment where you need to generate real business results. With increasingly limited budgets, social selling is one of the most cost-effective tactics being used by savvy marketing and sales organizations to create meaningful and memorable conversations with prospects and clients. These conversations ultimately help marketing and sales advance their brand and build and nurture relationships with qualified leads and prospects that drive top-line revenue.
Hey! Did you know you could get paid to travel the world and teach English? I'm Tamara with Let's TEFL, and I'm here to introduce you to the world of teaching English overseas. Native English speakers are in high demand all over the world. Think Thailand, China, Italy, Spain, and schools will pay around $2,000 to $3,000 per month for qualified teachers. It's a great way to see the world and get paid at the same time. With our online course, you can become a certified English language teacher and work all over the world. You don't need any previous teaching experience. You can study at your own pace and gain your qualification within a few weeks. We'll provide extra training to help you pass job interviews. And we'll even help you find an exciting job overseas. So what are you waiting for? Click the link below and get started today.
Many times I've discussed how you should brand yourself, and I would just have to add that you need to start now to build leadership into your brand. So lodge within your broader image is your brand as a leader. Your reputation as a potential leader may take years to fully develop, but it begins long before you manage a team or have a lofty title. Even when you are just starting out, your leadership reputation influences how much people trust you and whether they want to work with you. It starts in small ways. You look like a leader anytime you spot a problem. Create a plan to solve it and then execute your plan. You act like a leader when you treat other people with respect and you leave them feeling a bit more positive. And you can become known as a leader when you accept responsibility and follow through on what you promise. Now, in previous episodes, I have discussed about a full scope of your personal brand that includes the impression other people have about you, from your clothes to your technical skills. The leadership component of your brand is particularly important because it's close to your core values. If you have a strong leadership brand, other people will have faith in your ability to deliver at a high level.
Beyond that, when you are clear about the kind of leader you want to be, your own standards will help you to make decisions. And once you decide how you want to be known, it will be easier to focus on your highest priorities. So how to make leadership part of your brand? How people regard your potential to lead is a significant part of what makes you distinctive. Your particular aura as a leader may have a huge impact on the kinds of opportunities that come your way. So let me describe you the four-part exercise that can help you define and project a leadership brand that will serve you well. In each episode, I really focus on a lot of things. So I want you to be ready with a pen and a paper every time you listen to my episode. So, the number one would be create your vision of leadership. A simple way to create your vision of the leader you will become is to compile a list of personal qualities that you want to develop and that you want others to see you in. Begin your vision by coming up with the names of leaders whom you admire. They could be teachers, bosses, or historic figures. When you have named 3 to 5 leaders, start your target list of personal qualities by asking yourself what characteristics set these people apart. Which of these characteristics do I want people to use when they describe me? Which of these qualities sounds most like me when I'm at my best? The number 2 would be expand your vision list. Review the words and phrases that many people have used to describe effective leaders and add to your own list any qualities that strike you as important. For example, always growing. The best leaders are constantly learning something new. It doesn't have to be a job related. Your development as a leader is tied to your development as a person, and the growth areas you pursue in your free time can impact the way you show up on the job. Or you self-aware and good at building relationships. That's another characteristic. Research by leadership expert Daniel Goleman suggests that strong leaders are distinguished from the mediocre ones by their level of emotional intelligence. And that means you have self-awareness, like noticing when you are too hungry or distracted to handle a delicate matter. So in his book, Social Intelligence, Goleman says we are wired to connect with one another. By becoming more self-aware, we get better at managing our interactions with others. Another trait is positive. A leader's attitude has an enormous impact on the team. The most people are more productive when they are around positive people. Another trait is engaged. To lead, we must be actually focused on people and activities around us. Other people can sense whether we tend to stay present in the moment, which can influence whether they see us as genuine and charismatic leaders. Service-oriented. Leadership may begin with a feeling that you want to help others, perhaps by delivering what they need or helping them to succeed. The concept of servant leadership emphasizes attributes like kindness, trust, empathy, and the ethical use of power. Well organized. Good intentions aren't enough to deliver results. To achieve their goals, effective leaders develop work habits and systems associated with productivity. Collaborative. There is a big demand for people who can work well with others to achieve shared goals. One reason for this is that innovation is so often the outgrowth of collaboration, involving people with different views and skill sets. Energetic. To be at their best, leaders must manage not just their time, but also their energy. This includes physical energy, which is linked to exercise, nutrition, and stress management. Now, these are the attributes. Now, the next thing would be number 3, study your vision list. Now that you have a list of the leadership qualities you intend to develop, Post it in the conspicuous place and look at it frequently, including each morning, because we tend to remember pictures more easily than words. Some people like to create an icon to represent the characteristics they are working on. Bill, a client, came up with 5 attributes to find his style of leadership. For each one, he created a symbol picture, to capture a quality he wanted to develop. Because he's an avid biker, he was training for a mountainous 100-mile ride. His symbol for perseverance was a triangle, representing a challenging mountain. Bill could glance at his sketch of those 5 icons and instantly recall the characteristics he hoped to develop as a leader. Eventually, to thank his wife for supporting his efforts, he had a jeweler find or create each of the icons in a charm. Then he was reminded of his growth path each time he looked at the lovely gold bracelet that his wife wore. Number 4. Act this way. A key to projecting your brand is identifying the attributes and behaviors that will earn the reputation you want. Once your vision list is complete, a quick look will remind you of how to act. You might also consider a methodical way to practice the qualities on the list one by one. If you are working on several characteristics, you might try to flavor of the month approach. Let's say you want colleagues to see you as reliable, creative, and positive. Go to your calendar, and for each of the next 3 months, choose one attribute to be your theme for the month. Now, here is the most important part. If be reliable is your target for May, commit to be specific type of behavior to bolster your reputation for reliability. For example, you might plan to arrive right on time for every May meeting. Your brand sets you apart from the competition, and your brand as a leader reflects and influences the way other people encounter your deepest values.
Hello, this is Sara Yusupov, Staba Manchon, Let's Talk Careers with Sara, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern, where I will discuss about your dream job, career coaching, answering your questions regarding careers, exclusively on TuneIn Satellite and the Armed Radio Global Networks.
Did somebody tell you that if you work hard and do a great job, it won't matter what you wear to work? Sorry, that's just not the case. The way you present yourself to others, to other people, has an impact on how they evaluate your accomplishments and potential. And your personal style, your clothes and grooming makes a difference to the way you're perceived. Obviously, your style is particularly important when you're job hunting or making presentations. Thinking about these occasions, I went to an expert, my sister, Libby Vick. Libby spent 10 years in Washington politics and public relations, and for more than 20 years has been on the faculty at Northern Virginia Community College. In her business and professional communication classes, students of all ages and backgrounds explore how they come across on the job or in the job market. Whether you are giving a speech or just trying to make a good impression, Libby says your audience may focus less on your words than on your nonverbal messages. In addition to things like posture and facial expressions, personal style is a part of that message. Having a tasteful look doesn't require lots of money. Libby believes you can look smart whenever it's evident you thought carefully about how to put yourself together. Women on the tight budget can still appear stylish, even men. One approach that often works is to wear mostly black or black and white. For men, dressing for success is both more flexible and more complicated than it used to be. A good tactic is to see how others dress and come up with a look that's a bit less casual than most guys in the group. But male or female, and whatever look you select, make sure your clothes are clean and pressed. You'll feel better about yourself when you know you look good, and chances are you'll perform better as well. Libby says that in her early teaching days, she didn't require students to dress up for presentations. Then she realized the speeches they give when they're wearing sweats to class are nothing like the speeches they give when they know they look good. Libby concludes that everything comes back to focusing on your audience and recognizing that all good communication is audience-centered. To give some thought to messages you want to communicate and what you look will convey to the people you are trying to reach. If it's apparent that you make an effort, they may be more open to what you have to say. So it's time to kick your style up a notch. Sometimes you feel too busy, tired, or disengaged to make an effort as you prepare for the workday. Losing interest in your appearance can be part of downward spiral in your career. When that happens, a bit of a makeover might help you to break out of the funk. Another time for a redo is when your career is on an upswing. A chic new look can be a subtle way to let the world know that you are on a roll. And you may want to buff up your look when you, let's say, work with younger people. If your wardrobe hasn't changed in years, they may assume that your mindset is back in the 90s as well. Notice what your young colleagues are wearing and modify your choices to create a look that works for you. If you don't know where to begin, ask for advice from a fashionable friend, explore fashion blogs, or find a personal shopper. I, for example, have an Instagram, a site from Let's Talk Careers with Sarah, which is Sara Yusupov 10X. I have another Instagram that is called Outfit Collection with Sarah. And you can see lots of outfits out there that are really good for your performance, for your work, for any special occasions. It's really a mixed variety that you might like. So I encourage you to go and check it out. Outfit Collection with Sarah. So you may want to buff up your look when you work with older people. If it won't help your career if you look like a kid. Get rid of the flip-flops if your colleagues will think your informal dress suggests you don't mean business. You may want to change your look when you interact with clients or customers. You won't make much of an impression if you are dressed like you don't really care. You'll be more credible if you look as if you considered all the details, including what you wear. And you want to change your outfit when you are giving a speech. Now, Libby says it's toughest whenever you make a presentation. What with audiences constantly yearning to check their phones, no matter how well you know your material, you'll lose your audience at the beginning if you look sloppy, uncertain, or unprepared. Dress up a bit in an ensemble that makes you look good and you will get off to a strong start. Change your look when you hope to move up. If you are eyeing a promotion, dress like you have already climbed that ladder. Instead of blending in with your peers, take cue from your bosses or their bosses and dress as if you are one of them. Change your wardrobe if you are seeking a new position. In interviews, first impressions are critical, and people will register how nicely you have cleaned up even before you open your mouth. Dressing conservatively is often the safest bet, but you will also want to look like you fit in with the office culture. Being a little overdressed is acceptable because it shows the interviewer how much you care. If you want to avoid stereotypes, my hip mother, Lorna Jones, passed her driving test at age 93. I asked if she'd be nervous about driving with a motor vehicle department official in her car, and she said it had been no problem because she was prepared. I had my hair done, and I dressed up like a professional, and said after 80, if you dress casually or look untidy, people may assume you have a dementia. When you look classy, folks are more likely to put their prejudices aside. In a work setting, your personal image is a part of your brand. It suggests something about how much you value the work and how you expect others to treat you.
Hey, did you know you could get paid to travel the world and teach English? I'm Tamara with Let's TEFL, and I'm here to introduce you to the world of teaching English overseas. Native English speakers are in high demand all over the world. Think Thailand, China, Italy, Spain, and schools will pay around $2,000 to $3,000 per month for qualified teachers. It's a great way to see the world and get paid at the same time. With our online course, you can become a certified English language teacher and work all over the world. You don't need any previous teaching experience. You can study at your own pace and gain your qualification within a few weeks. We'll provide extra training to help you pass job interviews. And we'll even help you find an exciting job overseas. So what are you waiting for? Click the link below and get started today.
Are you ready to land your dream job? Your dream job is waiting for you. You want to transition. You want to be a leader. You want to have the mindset of how to nail that interview. This ebook is exactly for you. It's a workbook that requires you to think a little bit and know what to expect when someone is going to ask you that question. That is actually a great plan for you to understand what you will be asked and what you need to ask yourself as well in order to get the right answers. It's a ebook that requires you to write your thoughts, your opinions, and answer the questions that's there. It's only $17. I require you to go to Sara Yusupov, sarayusupov.blogspot.com/shop. In that section, you will see exactly what you need. It's a great breakthrough if you want to change your career. Again, it's sarayusupov.blogspot.com/shop. The link is in the description below. If you like this episode, please follow and share it with others. Join my group on Facebook called Let's Talk Careers Inner Circle. If you would like to be featured on my show, let me know in the group. And I have an event coming up, Career Readiness Workshop. It's on August 20 at 7:30 p.m. You will learn about job strategies, interview skills, and this will be your opportunity to network with others. More details on bit.ly/career readiness workshop.